Good morning, everyone, and welcome to The Bridge. If you're joining us online and just checking us out, thank you for joining. Let's all stand, and we're going to open with a word of prayer before we worship. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for today. Thank you that we can come into your house this morning. I just pray that you surround us, Lord, with your Holy Spirit today as we worship you and as we learn about you. Thank you, Lord, for the freedom that we have to come into your house this morning. Just give all those who are watching and all those who are attending in person a special blessing today. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. I meet with you. My soul sings out as your word throws down far away. I sing to you and my heart cries holy, hallelujah, Father, you're here. My hope is in you, Lord, all the day long. I
good. so great a mercy. What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me.
It's all about
about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. King of endless words, no one could express how much you I'm weak and poor. All I have is yours, every single breath. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within.
Kids are excused to go to Bridge Kids, and we'll turn it over to Pastor Craig.
Thank you. Well, good morning. Good morning. Great. We look to the book of Luke again, and to an interesting section of scripture, and we'll, as we talk about it, you'll kind of hear why I think this is such an interesting and intriguing set of verses. We're working through the book of Luke and talking about being with Jesus. And boy, we're already ahead of ourselves. Okay. The text for this morning is Luke 3, 21 through 38. And as we open, if you open your Bibles to that, remember that we're looking at this from Luke's eyes. He is the great physician. He has spent time with Paul, and now he's writing to his friend Theophilus. And I just want to go back and reacquaint you with the words as Luke begins his book. In Luke chapter 1, he says this: "Inasmuch as many have undertaken to compile a narrative of the things that have been accomplished among us, just as those who from the beginning were eyewitnesses and ministers of the word have delivered them to us. It seemed good to me also, having followed these things closely for some time past, to write an orderly account for you, most excellent Theophilus, that you may have certainty concerning the things you have been taught." Now understand, in that Luke is saying, look, Theophilus, I want you to have certainty about what you're being taught. And understand, he's not just saying, you have been taught things and so I am reinforcing them, but he's saying, here is information to help you be certain, to correct error, and to lead you in truth. And so Luke is saying, look, I have carefully researched this. I've talked to those witnesses. I have put all of this together, and this is what I'm giving to you. And so he writes the book of Luke and the book of Acts to his friend Theophilus. And so what I want to do is first kind of divide this into two sections. To first read the section, you know, Luke 3, 21 through 38, and we won't read all of the genealogies, and you can kind of wipe your brow and say good for that. And I'm not going to ask anybody else to read them out loud either with all the names in them. But we're going to look at the scriptures and just kind of briefly get a picture of what's happening, and then we'll go back and ask some questions about those scriptures. So as we look at Luke chapter 3, verse 21 begins, "Now when all the people were baptized and when Jesus also had been baptized," now stop there. I mean, understand that one of the things that gets me about all four of the gospel accounts of the baptism is their brevity. I mean, and Jesus was baptized. And it doesn't give us much detail. It gives us some detail after, but not so much going into it, just Jesus was baptized. In fact, Luke's gospel tells us, here's what John was doing. Here's what John was doing in baptizing people. And so while all these people were being baptized, Jesus came and was baptized too. Okay. So we move on from there. So Jesus also had been baptized, and the next section says, and was praying, the heavens were opened. So Jesus is baptized, and we're not real sure if what this and was praying. Was he praying as he came out of the water? Did he come out of the water and begin praying? Luke's the only gospel that records that Jesus was praying. And as I read through this, it was kind of interesting. I'm reading through it and reading through it, and I noticed I had highlighted in my Bible and circled the word praying. But when I think of Jesus' baptism, I don't necessarily think of him praying. That's not the picture I get. I get a picture of him praying and then the different events. But Luke says, you know, it's almost as if the Holy Spirit is telling Luke as he's writing this, that he's saying, okay, here's something the other ones don't mention, that Jesus was praying. And somehow for Luke, that is significant, that when he comes out of the waters of baptism, he's praying. And now here's where it gets interesting, because he comes out and he's praying, and the heavens were opened. And I just, okay, if you have been baptized, is that your experience when you were baptized? And we don't see that in any of the Gospels concerning any other baptism, that the heavens were opened. And I thought about that phrase, the heavens opened. It appears 5 times in Scripture that the heavens were opened. It happens in Genesis chapter 7 with Noah in the ark. The heavens were opened and it started to rain. It happens in Ezekiel, the first chapter, as the prophet Ezekiel is receiving visions, he says the heavens were opened. It happens here with the baptism of Jesus. It happens in Acts chapter 7, where when Stephen is being stoned, as he is dying, he sees the heavens open. And then in Acts chapter 10, when Peter receives the vision of the unclean animals, heaven is opened and a sheet comes down full of unclean animals. And maybe you're familiar with those stories, maybe you're not, but those are the only 5 times where that phrase, the heavens open. So this is a significant event. And I have some questions, but we'll get to those questions in a moment. And so the heavens are open, and the Holy Spirit descended on him in bodily form like a dove. It seems as if, when you read it just straight through, that the heavens open, and the opening of the heavens is so that the Holy Spirit can descend in bodily form from heaven and descend like a dove onto Jesus Christ. What a visual display. We have no reason to think that as crowds were coming to John to be baptized, that the baptism of Jesus takes place somewhere else, in like a private ceremony, but rather that Jesus came and there was a group of people around them, and these people saw the heavens open and the Holy Spirit descend in bodily form like a dove. Can you imagine seeing that? I mean, it's hard to imagine with any type of grandness that picture. I mean, it's just like, you know, somebody goes to the Grand Canyon and they see and they take a picture and they come back and show you the picture. You know, the picture just isn't the same. And no matter how we imagine this picture, it isn't grand. You know, I haven't shown pictures of my grandchildren for a while, but that's what I think. Yeah, I need to show you pictures of my grandchildren, but it just doesn't do them justice. You know, it just doesn't do them justice. And that's this, whatever our imagination is of this event, it just doesn't do it justice. Imagine the people who were seeing the real event. And then not only is there this visual display, of the Spirit coming down, but then there's a voice. John, when he records this display of the Spirit coming down, John, in his recording of the baptism, John chapter 1 says, I myself didn't know him, but he who sent me to baptize with water said to me, he on whom you see the Spirit descend and remain, this is he who baptizes with the Holy Spirit. And I have seen and borne witness that this is the Son of God. Now, when we put all four gospel accounts together, John recognizes Jesus. In fact, he said, I baptize with water. One is coming who will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. And with fire, I'm not worthy to untie his shoelaces. And the other accounts say that when Jesus comes to John, John even says, look, I don't need to baptize you. You need to baptize me. And Jesus makes the reply that, no, we do well to conform that all the, with all that God requires. And so Jesus is baptized. But it's as if there is a moment of illumination when this Holy Spirit comes, because God has said, when you see this, you'll know. John, you're baptizing. You're preparing people for the way. You're going to introduce Jesus to people, and you'll know him because the Holy Spirit will come down and descend on heaven and stay with him. So John sees Jesus coming, and he says, okay, I need to be baptized by you. And Jesus said, no, I want you to baptize me. It happens, and the Holy Spirit descends upon Jesus, and John the Baptist gives this great revelation. I saw it. This is the Son of God. This is him. You know, it's not just my cousin. It's not just the one who, when I found out my Aunt Mary was pregnant, even before I was born, I leaped for joy in my mother's womb. This is him, the Son of God. And then, as if the descending of the Holy Spirit from heaven isn't enough, it says, a voice came from heaven, you are my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. You have this fantastic visual confirmation of Jesus Christ, and now you have this audible confirmation. And I wonder, did God ever have to speak this way again? Now, what do I mean by that? I mean, the angel appears to Mary and says, Mary, this is what's going to happen, and it happens, and we don't hear of the angel coming back to Mary at any point saying, it's going to be okay, it's going to be okay, it's going to be okay. And an angel appears to Joseph, and we don't have any other special revelation to Joseph. And an angel appears to Zechariah, and we don't have any other special revelation. And each of those, after they have received a special revelation, we don't find any more special messages specifically to them. It's as if God has said, okay, I've said it, and that's enough. You know, it's like the husband and wife got married, and some years later, she's saying, you never say you love me. So when we got married, I told you I loved you. If anything changes, I'll let you know. You know? And we know that's not enough, but sometimes we treat God like that. God, you've said that you love me. You gave Jesus Christ for my sin. You have saved me. But what have you done for me lately? Now, we know that there's another point at the transfiguration. When Jesus goes into the mountain and is transfigured, that a voice comes from heaven. I'm not sure that it is for the same purpose as it is here. Have you had that experience in your life? That's my first question. That was the question I asked myself. Have I had that experience in my life where if God never says, never does another thing for me, has what he has said, has what he done already been enough? And it's just like, I want to say no, it's not enough. And I want to say no so that I can prod God into doing more. God, it's not enough, you better do something else. But the truth is, I look at my life, I say, it doesn't matter anymore. God has got such a hold on me that if he doesn't do anything else, this is enough. Dayenu, the old Hebrew word that says it is sufficient. What has been said is sufficient. What he has done is sufficient. And I asked myself in preparation, is it enough to hear the voice of God one time and not again? It is. And my question is, have you had that experience? To hear God's voice one time or enough times that it's sufficient that you are now in his care and you trust that beyond anything else? And we'll come back when we end the message to that thought. But now is when I turn, after I've read these verses, the next verse, 3:23, a voice came from heaven saying, "Who I'm well pleased," and it follows up, Jesus, when he began his ministry, was about 30 years of age, and then we have the genealogy. Here's what I believe. When Jesus received the Holy Spirit after being baptized, he began his ministry. This is where it starts. Now, we don't see him interacting with people for a while, but this was his commissioning service, his ministry starts, and then everything that follows now is a part of his earthly ministry. And what Luke does is say, okay, so he's about 30 years old when all this happens, and here's who he was. I think there's a couple reasons for this, but if you look at the genealogy, you'll say, well, you can go back to Matthew chapter 1 where there's a previous genealogy and you see that they're different. There are several explanations that I've read for that. One, that the genealogy in Matthew is of Joseph, the supposed father of Jesus, and that Luke's genealogy is the genealogy of Mary, who was the mother, but it says Joseph, but it's actually Mary. Others believe that it was Joseph's genealogy, but not through Joseph's father, but through his mother and the mother's father, and that's why there's a difference. Both of them, Matthew goes from Abraham to David to Solomon, where Luke's goes from Adam, all the way back to Adam, to David, but instead of tracing it through Solomon, he traces it through Nathan. And so we have this divergent before they all come back together. Now, here's where I turn into, I don't know, a 2, a 3, a 4-year-old. Because there's a word that children learn sometime in that age range. And if they learn it at 2, it lasts for a couple years, or 3, it goes on what seems like, if you're a parent, seems like an eternity. You know what the word is? Why? And not only do they learn the word, they know the definition because they're wanting explanations. Why? And I get to this section of scripture and that's what I feel like. I'm 3 years old again and I want to know why. So the first question is, why was Jesus baptized? I mean, really, look, why was Jesus baptized? I mean, what was John's baptism? Baptism of repentance for forgiveness and to change your way of life. Did Jesus need to repent? I mean, we all believe that Jesus was the sinless Son of God. Was he only sinless after he was baptized? Did he have a childhood more like mine? Or yours? Well, we look back and say, well, Jesus was sinless, and I ask that question, why was he baptized? What's the point of him being baptized? Well, Matthew says, well, he replies, we do well now to conform with all that God requires. We do it to fulfill righteousness. But then I think, you know what? Here's the picture. John's going out, people are coming out to him, and he's performing these baptisms of repentance to people. We look back and say, this was Jesus, the sinless Son of God. Those people gathered around John being baptized, when they looked at Jesus, he was another face in the crowd. He's just another person. When he goes down into the water, there's nothing different or significant to them about him. It isn't until after he's baptized that something different happens. Why was Jesus baptized? Perhaps as an example. Because he knew who he was what he was about, and he's beginning this ministry, and so he does it to show other people, here's what it's all about. It's about forgiveness. Did he need to be forgiven? No. Did he need to set an example? Yeah. I just find that an interesting question. John 1:31 says, John the Baptist came baptizing with water that he, Jesus, might be revealed to the world. So John, the forerunner of Christ, came to prepare a way. He's baptizing people. Why does he baptize Jesus Christ? Why is there this great display in heaven and this voice? That Jesus might be revealed. All the people around Jesus' baptism saw it, experienced it, and can you imagine the way that news spread? In fact, perhaps we don't do it justice because we read it and think, wow, what a great story. But we're not overwhelmed by the awesomeness that what John did, came and did throughout his ministry, he did that the Messiah might be revealed. So much so that when John baptizes Jesus and he sees the display, he says, this is the Son of God. This is Messiah. So why was he baptized? Why were the heavens opened? I mean, why was there that display? I mean, couldn't a dove have descended on him anyway? Why this tremendous act that only happens 4 other times in Scripture? The only thing I think is it was the awesomeness of display. It removes all doubt. The people who were there, John the Baptist, and Jesus all witnessed this grand commissioning, and that there was no doubt what was happening. The heavens opened, and I don't even know what that means, that the heavens opened. I mean, was it a day like today? It's blue sky, maybe a few clouds, and all of a sudden, the heavens open and it's nighttime? I mean, now they see stars? I mean, is heaven opened and they see the throne of God? It gives us no description of what that means that the heavens were opened, but it had to be some display so that when people saw it, Luke could record eyewitnesses who said, man, the heavens were opened. Now, when we talked about that earlier, you probably formed some type of picture. And I don't know what it was. But all we can do is imagine the grandness of this event and speculate what it might have been. But here's the fact. Somehow, whatever it means, God opened the heavens up. Why? Well, maybe to remove all doubt. Because the next part of the verse says that a dove, the Holy Spirit descended in the form of a dove. Okay, now I have to ask this. And maybe it reveals too much about me. I don't know. When you hear the question, why a dove, what do you think? I think, why not a chicken? Yeah, the dove was a symbol given to Noah. But if you've ever seen the movie Coconuts with the Marx Brothers, somebody raise your hand, even if you're lying, raise a hand so I don't feel alone. Thank you very much, I appreciate it. There's a part in the movie, and I wanted to play a clip, but I couldn't find one with a good audio, where Groucho and Chico were talking about going to an auction. And Groucho is giving directions to Chico, and Groucho says, you know, in getting there, he says, there's a viaduct from the mainland to the peninsula. And Chico says, well, a viaduct. And he says, well, a viaduct that leads from the mainland to the peninsula. And he says, well, viaduct. He says, well, it's just a viaduct. And Chico says, well, viaduct, why not a chicken? And I love the line Groucho responds, you try to cross over on a chicken and you'll find why a duck. So, I'm sorry. I should never have brought that up. But when I ask my question, why a dove? Why not a chicken? Why not a duck? Why not an eagle? Well, part of the problem is our perception. Look what it says. The heavens opened, and the Holy Spirit descended upon him in bodily form like a dove. Does it say that the Holy Spirit descended as a dove? No. The Holy Spirit descended and remained on Jesus Christ in bodily form like a dove. Was it a dove? How do you describe something you've never seen before? You see something, you've never seen it before, how do you describe it? You describe it according to something that you do know, that you do have experience with. So did the Holy Spirit descend as a dove? It descended in bodily form like a dove. So all we know is the Holy Spirit, according to the Synoptic Gospels, that the Holy Spirit descended in bodily form like a dove, not as a dove, but like a dove, and according to John, it remained with Jesus. See, Ezekiel describes in his prophecies a wheel within a wheel, and he gives all these, but he's describing something he hadn't seen before, so he's using a simile or a metaphor. Those who are closer in proximity to your high school English would know the difference, but he's using a comparison to say this. And so it isn't that a dove came and landed on Jesus' shoulder, and John says the Spirit remained with him, so Jesus appears like some type of pirate walking around the rest of his life with a dove on his shoulder. The Holy Spirit descended on Jesus, and it stayed with Jesus. Why a dove? Because John didn't know how else, or Luke didn't know how else to describe it. In Acts chapter 2, the Holy Spirit comes upon the people in the upper room, and it appears as tongues of fire. Does that mean there were these tongues of fire? Luke, in writing, he doesn't know how else to describe something that they hadn't seen before. And so that's what it was like. But the Holy Spirit descends from heaven and stays with Jesus. Why does God speak? I mean, is it this enough? The heavens are open, the Holy Spirit comes upon Jesus Christ. See, did the Holy Spirit say, this is my Son, in whom I am well pleased? Was it an audible voice for all the people who were witnessing the event to hear, so that they would know exactly who this is? Was it to John? Because John had been told, apparently by God, according to the Gospel of John the Baptist, recording in John the Gospel, two different people, that the Baptist would know this was Messiah because the Holy Spirit would come and stay. And so this is confirmation to John, this is him. Or was it to Jesus? Jesus, you've spent 30 years getting ready for this. It's time to start. And you're my Son. I love you. Well, I would guess I would think it was probably all of the above. That it was an audible display to everyone who not only saw it, but to everyone who can read it now, to understand when Jesus is baptized, this is a magnificent event in which the heavens are open, the Holy Spirit comes upon him, and a voice says, this is my Son in whom I am well pleased. And it's almost as if you're not convinced by now who Jesus is, I don't know how much his ministry is going to convince you. It doesn't stop there. Why another genealogy? I mean, Matthew has a genealogy. Luke has a different genealogy. And why genealogies in the first place? You ever write a resume and include your genealogy? Some of us would say, absolutely not. At first it seems odd, and I think when we read it, any thinking person would say, what's this about? And you're probably saying, well, how did you come up with it? And why the difference? Now, here's what scholars say, and I think it's probably a good explanation of the difference, that Matthew, in presenting his book, he's saying, here is your king. When you read the book of Matthew, it is about the kingship of Jesus Christ. And so he goes back to the original Jew, Abraham. And he says, here is the royal line of Jesus traced back through his supposed father, through all of the kings who reigned in Israel over the tribes of Judah, all the way back to David, and from David back to the original Jew, Abraham. And here's this royal line that ends in Jesus. Jesus is the rightful heir to the throne, promised to David, promised to Abraham. But Luke's genealogy swerves. His does not go back through the kings of Israel, of Judah in the land of Israel. His genealogy goes through a bunch of names that, you know, we're not even sure of. You know, that show up here and some of them nowhere else. But it does go back to David. But instead of going back to David and then to Abraham, it goes past Abraham all the way back to Adam. See, here's the difference. Matthew is saying, here is your king, the rightful heir to the throne. And Luke is saying, here is the man, Jesus Christ. Here is the Son of God. Not the king, but the Son. Not Messiah, the rightful heir to the throne, but Messiah, the Son of Man. And what we're going to do, we're going to look at the book of Luke and find out Luke is all about his humanity. That's why the difference in genealogies. But the other thing I think it shows, whichever genealogy you choose, from Adam or from Abraham, what we're seeing is God at work. Here's God at work, because this guy had a son who had a son who had a son who had a son, all the way down till the time is right for Jesus Christ to be born. And although God is his father, this whole lineage shows that God is at work. See, and that takes me back to that question, is it enough for us? At what point do we say, God, you've done enough, you've got me. It doesn't matter what else happens in my life, you've got me. I trust you. You know, what difference do the scriptures make? God has been working throughout time. And at the right time, John the Baptist comes to prepare the way for Jesus Christ. And John is told, you'll recognize him by the presence of the Holy Spirit. And so Jesus is baptized by John, heavens are open. The Holy Spirit comes upon him. A voice from heaven speaks. John says, this is him. In fact, God says, this is him. And it's time for him to begin his ministry. Back to the question, what's your experience? Have you had that experience with God where he has you? I came across this quote this week. I couldn't find who originally said it, but you can tell people I did. Fear says, what if? Faith says, even if. Fear says, what if? Faith says, even if. Job 13, 15, and we know of the troubles, the struggles, the trials of Job. Job in chapter 13 says, though he slay me, I will hope in him. See, by the time Satan sought to destroy Job's life, Job had such a hold of God that he couldn't let go. These verses challenge me. Do I have such a, not does God have such a hold on me? I know he won't let go. But do I have that same grip on God that I won't let go? That nothing happens in this life that can cause me to say, what if? But everything that comes into my life is an even if. I probably shouldn't say this, and I'm not making a commitment, but when I look around the world that we live in right now, I wonder if it's the end times. Now, let me preface it by saying, as long as I can remember, there's been people saying, it's the end times. Things have never been this bad before. Never in my life have I asked that question. But I'm starting to, as I look around. Next week is Communion Sunday, and so I have a message concerning that. I think we're going to interrupt our look at Luke for a few Sundays. And the reason why was I heard a movie advertised, and the name of the movie was What to Expect When You're Expecting. And I don't know if you've seen the movie or not, but it has to do, I believe, with several women who are pregnant, and it's what they should expect when they're expecting. But as I heard that, I was not thinking about pregnancy or family issues, and that's not what the messages will be about. The messages will be about what do we expect as Christians as we are expecting the return of Jesus Christ. Say, I expect Jesus Christ to return. So what should I expect while I'm expecting Jesus? So I think we're going to do a series of messages. Now, it could be that next week I'll tell you, we're staying with Luke. This is way over my head. And that's my first inclination, because I've never been a prophecy student. But when I look at this, the baptism of Jesus, this grand commissioning service of Jesus Christ, he was here, this happened. And that was sufficient for the people at the time. That was sufficient for Jesus Christ. It's sufficient enough for me to convince me that he who came is coming. And what can I expect? What can I expect? And am I prepared for those expectations? Because if I am expecting Jesus to come and I'm expecting the wrong things, then fear may cause me to say, what if this happens? Instead of saying, even if this happens, though he slay me, I will hope in him. Let's bow for prayer. Father, I thank you for the testimony of Luke. I thank you for the story and the excitement it brings as Jesus is commissioned into services. He receives the Holy Spirit. Father, I thank you that through him we have the hope of your power coming upon us to enable us to live lives that measure up to your calling. Father, I thank you for the grand picture, that it isn't one event, but it's a whole series of events in our life that convince us of who you are and of your activity. May we anticipate it with joy and with hope, with thanksgiving and praise. Father, as we end this service, I just pray that you will work in our hearts and minds to ask questions that you will answer. For I believe that every question mark we have, you have an exclamation point for us. I pray it to be so in Jesus' name. Amen. So as we conclude the service, we just offer the invitation that if something has challenged you in your life through the service, if you have questions, please contact us. You can email, you can text, you can go through the website. And please let us know. Please let us help you in your journey of coming to know and growing in Jesus Christ the Messiah. Let's be dismissed in prayer. Let's stand, please. Father, as we've looked into your word, we have prayed your Holy Spirit would be with us to teach us, to instruct us, to help us understand your word. And as we leave this place, Father, may we be lights shining in the darkness. May we be instruments that you will use as you used John to give witness to the Messiah that this is the Son of God. Father, embolden us to follow up on our thoughts, on our impressions, that we may be before you as instruments that you will use in your ministry. For we pray it to be so in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.